ஆழ்வார் திருவடி கடை சரணம், எம்பெருமானார் திருவடி கடை சரணம், பிள்ளைலோக்காச்சாரிய திருவடி கடை சரணம், ஜீயர் திருவடி கடை சரணம், ஜீயர் திருவடி கடை சரணம். வி ஆர் சீயிங் தி மீனிங்ஸ் ஃபார் மோக்ஷப்படி சூத்திரம்ஸ் வித் தி ஹெல்ப் ஆஃப் மணவாள மாமணிகள்ஸ் காமெண்ட்ரி. மோக்ஷப்படி வாஸ் கம்போஸ்ட் பை பிள்ளைலோக்காச்சாரியா. பிள்ளைலோக்காச்சாரியா இஸ் கன்சிடர்ட் அஸ் அ great acharya who has most compassionately given us the rahasya granthams in a very comprehensive way. Among his many rahasya granthams, mumukshupadi is considered as the foremost because it explains deeply about rahasya trayam, trimantram dvayam charma shlokam, which in turn explain deeply about Artha Panchakam. So this grantham is considered as very foundational grantham for all of Sri Vaishnavas. So in this we have seen up to the 6th sutram. In the 5th and 6th sutrams we saw in the morning how Bhagavan revealed this Tirumantram to uplift all the jivatmas who are suffering in this world, and how it was very significant that when he revealed this mantram, he himself remained as both the acharya and shishya. While it is understandable that he remains as the acharya, there is a question why he himself need to be the shishya also. For that it was explained that because people of this world did not know how to be a proper shishya, Bhagavan himself wanted to demonstrate that practically. Hence he remained as the disciple himself and learned this meaning for this Tirumantram, learned the Tirumantram, Ashtaksharam. So that was 6th sutram. Now we have to move on to the 7th sutram. There is an introduction given by Manavada Mamnigal for the 7th sutram. There is a question here. Should Bhagavan remain as the disciple and as the acharya, should Bhagavan himself teach this Tirumantram and give the foundational knowledge in this manner? Is this required? Aren't there already Shastram like Vedam, which is already present, which is a tool for knowledge, Jnana Sadhanam? So Shastram is already there, Vedam and Vedantam, Itihasams, Puranams, Smriti, all of these are there already. Why can't one just pursue the path of Shastram and acquire knowledge? So that is the question here. Now that it is explained how this Tirumantram was taught by Bhagavan himself as Acharya and he learnt it as the Shishya also, the question here is why one should acquire the true knowledge through Tirumantram in this manner? Why not just go through the Shastram and learn it? And in this sutram, in the 7th sutram, Pillalokacharya explains the difference between the knowledge acquired through Shastram and knowledge acquired through this Tirumantram, Ashtaksharam, with an example. So that is the scope of this 7th sutram. Let us read the sutram. Sakala Shastrangalalum Pirakkum Jnanam Swayam Arjitam Pole திருமந்திரத்தாலே பிறக்கும் ஞானம் பைத்திருக தனம் போலே. As this மோக்ஷப்படி is in மணிப்பிரவாளம், that is a mixture of Sanskritam and Tamil words. Most of us, even those who don't know Tamil, will at least understand a good portion of the sutrams because there is a lot of Sanskrita terms in this. So here it is said by Pillalokacharya that சகல சாஸ்திரங்களாலும் பிறக்கும் ஞானம் ஸ்வயமார்ஜிதம் போலே. all the the knowledge acquired through all the shastram is like wealth earned on one's own effort. Trimantrathal pirakkum yanam paitrika dhanam pole. The knowledge acquired through Tirumantram, Ashtaksharam, is like hereditary wealth. So this is the difference between knowledge acquired through Shastram and knowledge acquired through Tirumantram. That is the meaning of this, simple meaning of this sutram. Now let us see the Vyakhyanam, commentary of Manavar Mamnikal. So here, the Shastram, the body of Shastram, it's made of Shruti, Smriti, Itihasam, Puranam, and Agamam, Sri Panchratra Agamam, and so on. All of these, and Divya Prabandham, Purvacharya Granthams, all of these make up the body of Shastram. Vedam is the foundational Shastram, Shruti, and all of the others, they help in understanding the Vedam in a better way. So here this knowledge which are given by all of these Shastram, this knowledge is like wealth acquired by one's own effort. So if some person goes and works hard for 20 years, 30 years, slowly accumulates wealth, and over time he becomes a very wealthy person. And this is the process which is similar to acquiring knowledge from Shastram. On the other hand, the knowledge acquired through Tirumantram from an Acharya, that is like hereditary wealth. For example, our grandfather had a big house, he had lots of wealth, lands, and so on. Eventually, the son and the grandson, they will get the wealth by that hereditary principle. So this is similar to how knowledge is acquired through Tirumantram, that is Ashtaksharam. So here it is effortless, that is in the hereditary wealth acquiring process. In that method, the wealth is acquired in an effortless manner. But in the case of acquiring wealth through one's own hard work, it's a lot of physical effort, lot of mental effort, lot of sacrifices, and so on. So that is the difference between acquiring knowledge through Shastram and acquiring knowledge through Tirumantram from an Acharya. Again, here Tirumantram is to be learnt by through an Acharya only. Similarly, Shastram also one has to learn from Acharya only. But here the Acharya is more compassionate, more caring towards the upliftment of the individual, Atma. That is the Shishya. So this difference is the main difference as highlighted by Pullaloka Acharya here. And Vamanigal is quoting one nice pramanam for that also. Shastra Jnanam Bahuklesham Buddhesh Chalana Karanam Upadeshat Harim Budva Virametu Sarvakarmasu. So this Pramanam explains that Shastra Jnanam, that is Jnanam acquired through Shastram, it entails lot of hard work, lot of difficulties. One has to go through Adhyayanam, one has to go through proper Vrathams, one has to go through lot of austerities, and then only they can learn Shastram. And it is also Buddhesh Chalanakaryam Karanam, that is, it also leads to confusion in the mind, because in Shastram, in some places there may be glorification of particular devatas, in some places there may be particular glorification of particular processes like Bhakti Yogam, Jnana Yogam, Karma Yogam, Tirunama Sankirtanam, Deshavasham, and so on. So lot of places where different aspects are highlighted. Why is that so? Because Shastram is Traihunya Vishaya Veda. That is, Vedam is meant for all kinds of people. Sattva, those who are in sattvagunam, those who are in rajogunam, those who are in tamogunam. So, different portions of Vedam will address such different kinds of people. So, we cannot see, unless one is knowledgeable, one is intelligent, one may get confused looking at what are all the different processes and glorification of devatas and so on. So, if that is the case, why is Shastram recommended? Because Shastram is for step-by-step progress. One may be in a lower level in Tamogunam, one may slowly attain Rajogunam and then finally Sattvagunam and so on. So, that progress, the option for progress is available in Shastram. But this Tirumantram, Ashtaksharam, this is very crisp, very short. It has got the essence of Shastram and it is focused on those who are directly desirous for moksham. So, the purpose of Shastram is those who are willing to and desiring to engage in worldly activities. The purpose of Ashtaksharam is for those who are desiring for liberation, eternal kaikaryam to Bhagavan. And also, Shastram is focused on Vishishta Vesham, that is the combination of body and soul. So, any of the karma in the Shastram that has to be practiced by us, we need the body to engage and to do all of that. And there is always the bodily context of doing certain purification, certain rituals and so on. But this Ashtaksharam, this Tirumantram, on the other hand, is for the exclusive Atma, for the upliftment of the Atma. So, it is directly focused on the Atma and hence it is applicable for all Atmas. So, there is difference between knowledge acquired through Shastram and knowledge acquired through Ashtaksharam. That is explained in this 7th Sutram. Next, 8th Sutram. Now, here Mamnigal gives an introduction. He says, okay, now leave aside the Shastram. There are so many mantras for Bhagavan. Is it just this Tirumantra which is present? Is this Ashtakshara the only one mantra? Are there not others? So, asking these questions, Pillalokacharya considers to highlight the greatness of Ashtaksharam. He gives a series of sutrams. And the first one in this series of sutrams is this 8th sutram where Pillalokacharya says, Bhagavan mantrangal tan anekangal. That is, the mantras which are present for Bhagavan, any mantra, we have seen that mantra means that which protects the one who meditates upon it. And the mantra has a particular object, a particular goal, a particular devata will be the object or the goal in the mantra. There will be an acharya who is teaching the mantra. So, we have seen all of that. So, there are so many mantras which are having Bhagavan as the goal. So, that is the main meaning of this 8th Sutram. Mamnigal gives beautiful explanation on how there are so many mantras. First, we have to understand how is it possible that there are so many mantras, and for that he is quoting a few pramanams. And there is a relationship between Bhagavan's qualities and Bhagavan's forms and Bhagavan's names. Every one of his quality is represented with a particular name. Every quality has a particular representative form. And in this manner, each form also has a particular name. And each of these names could be recommended in Shastram as mantra. So, we don't create the mantras. Usually, Shastram is giving the mantras. So, but how Shastram gives the mantras? It is by adding Pranavam and Namaha with the particular name. So, there is Keshava. So, the name is Keshava. Mantra will be Om Keshavaya Namaha. Similarly, there are so many names of Bhagavan, and each of that name could derive into a mantra as given by Shastram. So that is the main point in this sutram. Here Mamunigal quotes few beautiful pramanams in Sri Rangarajastavam. Parashara Bhattar in Uttarashatkam, Parashara Bhattar says, Astante guna rashivate guna parivahatmanam janmanam sankhya bhoma niketaneshvapi bhoma niketaneshvapi kuti kuncheshu rangeshvara. In this particular shlokam, Bhagavan's Ashtavatara greatness is highlighted. As part of that, here Parashara Bhattar is saying that, O Ranganatha, you are having so many different qualities, and in each of those qualities, in those each of those countless qualities, you have different names, and these qualities, they are from each of your incarnations. Let's say if we take Ramavatara, there are so many qualities in Ramavatara. In Krishna Avatara, there are so many qualities in Krishna Avatara. In each of that, there is a particular name. For each quality, there is a representing name for that. And you excel in houses, temples and many places. And you become fully dependent on the person who worships you. That is the scope of this shlokam, meaning of this shlokam. But here the important point is, Bhagavan has many incarnations, and in each incarnation he is having lots of qualities, and each quality is represented by a particular name. So that is one particular pramanam where Mamunigal quotes and establishes that Bhagavan has so many names, and each of these names could become a mantra. And then there is another quote, Bahavo Nirpa Kalyana Gunaha Putrasya Santite. So in this shlokam, this is in Sri Ramayanam, here it is said to Dasharatha that, O king, your son has so many good qualities. So Bhagavan here, Sri Rama, is glorified that he is having wonderful qualities. And then there is also another pramanam from Vishnu Dharmam, Tathavananta Gunasyapi Shadeva Prathame Gunaha. So here, in this shlokam, in this particular pramanam, it is said that even though you have so many countless auspicious qualities, six of those are of prime importance. That is, Bhagavan, the name Bhagavan is having Bha, Gha and Va. So these three letters, they indicate two qualities each. So Jnana Bala, Aishwarya Virya and Shakti Tejas are the six qualities which are highlighted in this name, in this particular name Bhagavan. And these six qualities are his primary qualities, says Vishnu Dharmam. And then there is also a Bhagavad Gita shlokam, which is quoted by Mamunigal here. Bahuni me vyatitani janmani tavasarjuna. So here he says that I take many births, you also take many births. But then Krishna says that my births are known to me and your births are not known to you. So here he is saying that there are many births for me, and obviously in each birth there will be a particular name. So all of these are supporting evidences for Bhagavan's multiple names. Even a simple thing which we will all accept, that there are multiple names for Bhagavan, Mamunigal is giving quotations from Shastram to establish that all of these are based on Shastram, not just imaginary. And then there is also Pasurams, Alvar's Pasurams, Enindra Yonimai Pirandai, Enil Tolpugal, Vanavarisane. There are so many such pasurams where Alvars glorify Bhagavan having many forms and many names and many qualities and so on. So, as said in all of these, there are so many forms, there are so many incarnations, so many qualities, and each of them will have a particular name and a mantra based on that. And also it is said in Shastram, Anantavai Bhagavan Mantraha, that there are so many mantras for Bhagavan. That is said in the Shastram itself. So that is another pramanam which is also explaining this aspect. So that is eighth sutram. Now ninth sutram, In this ninth sutram introduction, Mahamunigal inquires the scope of the ninth sutram. So here he is saying, Pilalokacharya is checking, are they just one kind? There are, we have established that there are so many names for Bhagavan. Are they just one kind, or are there multiple categories in them? For that, Pilalokacharya explains in the next sutra, in the ninth sutram here, that there are two categories in them, and they are called Vyapaka mantras and Avyapaka mantras. So that is ninth sutram. Avaidan Vyapakangal endrum Avyapakangal endrum irandu vargam. So these qualities of Bhagavan and these mantras, these names and mantras, they can be mainly categorized into two. First category is Vyapaka mantras, and then there is Avyapaka mantras. So Vyapaka mantras, what are those? Avyapaka mantras, what are those? That is going to be explained by Mahamunigal in the commentary. Let us see the Vyakhyanam. Bhagavan's Swarupam, that is his true nature, which is all pervading. So Bhagavan is known as Brahmam. Brahmam means that which is great, which is all pervading, which is present everywhere, which is huge, and so on. So this Bhagavat Swarupam, this true nature of Bhagavan, which is explained, which is revealed in certain mantras, and that those mantras are called Vyapaka mantras. And then there are other mantras which highlight Bhagavan's qualities, his avatarams, his leelas, and so many of the such aspects. Those which highlight Bhagavan's names, that is Bhagavan's avatarams, incarnations, qualities, and leelas, those mantras, they are known as Avyapaka mantras. So these two categories of mantras are present, says Pilalokacharya, and that is explained by Mahamunigal. That is ninth sutram. Now in the tenth sutram, Pilalokacharya is going to explain the greatness of Vyapaka mantra over the Avyapaka mantra. For that there is a introduction by Mahamunigal. Here Mahamunigal is asking, are these two categories at par? Are they of same level? And he is saying, Mahamunigal is saying, that Pilalokacharya is explaining that greater than the Vyapaka mantra, Avyapaka mantras, Vyapaka mantras are of much greater value. They are of much greatness. So that is 10th sutram. Avyapakangalil Vyapakangal moonrum sreshtangal. So in this, Pilalokacharya first says that Vyapaka mantras are greater, of greater significance than Avyapaka mantras. And he also establishes that there are three Vyapaka mantras. Among all the mantras, only three are highlighted as Vyapaka mantras, showing Bhagavan's all-pervading, omnipotent, omniscient nature, omnipresent nature, sorry. So that, those three names are only highlighted here. And let's see Mahamunigal's commentary here. So even more than the Avyapaka mantras, there are so many mantras we have seen. Beyond all of them, there is a greater, there are three mantras which are greater than all the other mantras, and those three mantras are derived from Vishnu Gayatri. Narayanaya Vidmahe Vasudevaya Dhimahi Tanno Vishnu Prachodayat. So in this Vishnu Gayatri, three mantras are highlighted: Narayana mantram, Vasudeva mantram, and Vishnu mantram. So these three mantras are highlighted, and these three, just being part of the Vishnu Gayatri, that itself says that these three names of Vishnu, names of Bhagavan, are more significant than all other names. And because they are also Vyapaka mantras, the names which relate to Bhagavan's omnipresence, they are considered as best among the mantras. So even more than all the other mantras, these three mantras are considered as the better ones. So that is 10th sutram. Next, 11th sutram. In this 11th sutram, Mahamunigal's introduction, he is asking, among these three Vyapaka mantras, are all of them considered at par? Are they same? Or is there any one of the mantram which can be considered as greater than all the greater than the other two? And Pillayalokacharya is explaining that Periyathiru mantram. Periyathiru mantram means Ashtakshara mantram. That is greater than the other two mantrams. So 11th sutram. Ivai moondrilum vaithukonde Periyathiru mantram pradhanam. Among these three mantras, the Vyapaka mantras, the foremost is Periyathiru mantram. That is Ashtakshara. Periyathiru mantram means the big, the great Thirumantram, Ashtaksharam. This is considered as the foremost, the best among the three mantras. Mahamunigal's commentary. So here, we've seen that Avyapaka mantras are there. Greater than them, there are Vyapaka mantras. And among these three, since the Vishnu Gayatri itself starts off with Narayanaya Vidmahe, so that itself gives precedence to importance to Narayana name. So that highlights the greatness immediately, and also due to the completeness in the meaning of the mantra. See, there is mantra and then there is mantra's meaning. We have already seen in the beginning itself, in the third sutram itself, right? There is Shabda Shakti and Artha Shakti. So by looking at the meaning, complete meaning which is present, the completeness of the meaning of the mantram also, this Ashtaksharam is much greater. Nasti, nasti cha Ashtaksharat paraha. There is no mantram which is greater than Ashtaksharam. Namantroshtaksharat paraha. There is no mantram greater than Ashtaksharam. There are some pramanams which highlight that this Ashtaksharam is the greatest of all the mantras. So this Thirumantram, this Ashtaksharam is considered as the foremost. So that is 11th sutram. Now, the next question is highlighted in the introduction section of the 12th sutram by Mahamunigal. He asks, okay, if you say that Ashtaksharam, Narayana mantram, is the foremost, then what is lacking in the other two mantrams? What are the inferior aspects in the other two mantrams? That is the question here. And for that, Pillayalokacharya explains that there are two defects which are to be observed in all the mantrams, and with those two defects, these two other two mantrams exist. And Ashtakshara mantram don't have those two defects. Hence, Ashtakshara mantram is greater than the other two mantrams. Now here, one thing we have to see, it is just a comparison. When Pillayalokacharya says that there is defect in the mantram, it is not a real defect, but it is just a comparative, analytic view of looking at things, that Ashtaksharam has completeness in it and the other mantrams are lacking such completeness. But all three are mantras glorifying Bhagavan and all three have their own place. So 12th sutram, Matrava irandukum ashishta parigrahamum apurthiyum undu. So here Pillayalokacharya is saying that for the other two, we have established that Thirumantram, Ashtaksharam is foremost. For the other two, there is two defects. Ashishta parigraham. Ashishta parigraham means pursuit by those who are not fully qualified. So that is one defect. And apurti. Apurti means incompleteness. There is incompleteness in the other two mantram. So these two defects are identified for the other two mantrams. Let us see Mamnigal's detailed Vyakhyanam. So here the Narayana mantram, Vasudeva mantram, Vishnu mantram. In this, Narayana mantram is known as Ashtakshari, Vasudeva mantram is known as Dwadasakshari, and then Vishnu mantram is known as Shadakshari. So 8-lettered mantram, 12-lettered mantram and 6-lettered mantram. These are the three mantrams. Here he is, Mamnigal is explaining, Vasudeva, Vishnu, Shabdams, these two mantrams, these two other mantrams which are having the words Vasudeva and Vishnu, they are not clearly revealing the Swarupa, Rupa, Guna, etc. of Bhagavan. So Narayana mantram fully reveals all of these aspects. Ashtaksharam reveals all of the aspects such as Bhagavan's Swarupam, Bhagavan's Rupam, Bhagavan's Gunam and all of that. We are going to see how it is. But these two other mantrams, they are not revealing them fully and clearly. And these two mantrams, they are just highlighting Bhagavan's Swarupam. What is Bhagavan's Swarupam? He is huge. He is all-pervading. That is his true nature. That is highlighted in all three mantrams. Narayana mantram also says that. Vasudeva mantram also says that. And Vishnu mantram also says that. But there are other aspects which are missing in these two other mantrams that we are going to see now. So it is only highlighting, the other two mantrams are only highlighting Swarupam. And then, because of this, Nirvishesha Chinmatra Vastuvadikal, that is, Mayavadis and other Siddhanta followers, they are known as Kudrishtis. They accept Vedas, but they misinterpret Vedas. So these people are known as Kudrishtis. They fully engage with these mantrams, that is Vasudeva mantram and Vishnu mantram. Because they don't really, this Vasudeva does not really highlight Bhagavan's names and forms and qualities and many other aspects. It is only talking about Swarupam. Similarly, Vishnu mantram also is only talking about Swarupam. So, those who are in the Mayavada, Advaita and other Veda Veda and many other thought process, they would have great attachment towards these two names. Because those other people who don't have full faith in Shastram, they don't fully represent Shastram, because they pursue this mantram, it is one of the reasons for us to not accept that mantram. So even when Bhagavad Vishayam is given by someone who is not fully faithful in the sampradayam, fully faithful towards our acharyas, even if that is given by such persons, even if great Bhagavad Vishayam is given by such persons, we should not be accepting from them, because they may have their own intentions, they may have their own prejudices, and they may try to push their ideas if we listen from them. So this is why our acharyas ensured that we listen to all the details, all the principles from our acharyas only, in our acharya parampara only, and they don't just randomly listen from everyone. So this is an important point. And then next aspect, so this is Ashishta Parigraham, that is Ashishtas, those who are not coming in the lineage of our acharyas, those who are outside our acharya parampara, they are Kudrishtis, they are pursuing these mantrams with great love, because they don't reveal Bhagavan's other aspects fully. And then, Vyapya Atyaharati Sapekshatai Agira Apurti. So there is Apurti in it. That is, here, for example, Vasudeva and Vishnu, both the mantras, they explain that Bhagavan is all pervading. Vasudeva means Sarvasya Vasati Iti Vasudeva. Vishnu means one who is all pervading, that's all. So here, there is no mention of what are all the entities being pervaded and what are all the qualities of Bhagavan who is pervading. All of those have to be loaded on top of the mantra. Just the Vasudeva or Vishnu will not sufficiently explain that. So we need additional information to understand that. That is going to be explained here. So that, because of that, there is apurthi, there is incompleteness in the in those two mantrams. So here shatakshari, so first he is addressing shatakshari. So shatakshari is not highlighting vyapya padartha, that is the objects which are pervaded, it is not mentioned there. Vyapana prakara, that is how it Bhagavan pervades, that is also not explained there. And vyapti phalam, what is the result of that pervading, that is also not explained in the shatakshari, that is Vishnu mantram. And finally the qualities of vyapaka, the one who is pervading, his qualities, that is also not explained. So that is in the shatakshari. Now next, so in here, because the objects which are pervaded, they are not present, so we have to add, for example, in the next Vasudeva mantram, Manavar Mamlika talks about Vasudeva mantram. When he says Vasudeva mantram, he is actually saying, see, in the case of Shatakshari, he just said Shatakshari, but in the case of Vasudeva mantram, he says Thir Dvadasha Akshari, that means Shri Dvadasha Akshari. So here he is adding the prefix Shri, and that is because this Dvadasha Akshari, that is Vasudeva mantram, that is Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya, this mantram is highly glorified in Shri Pancharatra Agama, and in Shri Rangam this Vasudeva mantram is greatly used in the temple worship. Hence he is giving special glory to Dvadasakshari. He is not just saying Dvadasakshari, he is saying Sri Dvadasakshari. So even though he says that, again in the end it is to be proved that it is also incomplete on its own. So there again he is saying that sarvam, in the meaning of the Vasudeva, sarvam vasati iti Vasudeva. So that sarvam vasati is explained separately, it is not in the Vasudeva term itself, it is an additional explanation which is given. And also further, to highlight that Bhagavan has qualities, that Bhagavat Shabdham is also added. So instead of just Vasudevaya Namaha, it is Bhagavate Vasudevaya Namaha. So here Bhagavat Shabdham is added to highlight, we saw right, recently we saw that there are six qualities which are important, Jnana Bala Aishwarya Virya Shakti Tejas, which is represented by the name Bhagavan. So this Bhagavate Shabdham word is added in the Vasudeva mantram. So in this manner, the Vasudeva mantram is also incomplete. So also Vyapti Phalam, that is what is the purpose of all pervasion, this all pervading nature, that is also not explained in the Vasudeva mantram. So because of these aspects, Narayana mantram Ashtakshari is greater than Vasudeva mantram and Vishnu mantram. So now in the final section, Mamnigal explains that in the Narayana mantram none of these defects are present. He says this mantram, unlike the other two, this Narayana mantram has the Vyapya Padartha, the objects which are pervaded. We will see in detail anyway going forward that, for example, this Narashabdham in the Narayana explains all the Atmas and all the Achetanas which are pervaded by Bhagavan. And then there are other aspects like Vyapana Prakaram, how Bhagavan pervades that. So there is Antarvyapti and Bahirvyapti, that is also explained in Narayanaya. In that term, that is also explained. Again, we are going to see all of that in detail. And then Vyapti Phalam, what is the purpose of this all pervasive nature, that is explained in the Ayapadam, that is Bhagavan will be served by all the Atmas. They are all subservient to him, and they will all serve him. So that is the Phalam of the all pervasive nature of Bhagavan. And then the Gunas, the qualities of Vyapaka, Bhagavan, that is also available in the Narayana Shabdam. All the qualities are available. So everything is explained in this particular Narayana Mantram in this Ashtakshari. So because of this, there is more completeness in the Narayana Mantram, and because of this completeness, because of this fullness, this Narayana Mantram Ashtakshari is considered as foremost and better than the other 2 months. So this is now Mamunigal has explained this beautiful section from starting from how we where we started Shatakshari, that Shatakshari has does not show many of the aspects from that section up to here. Mamunigal quotes that the all of this, that is Apurti and Ashishta Parigraham in the other 2 mantras, and Purti and Shishta Parigraham, that is Shishta Parigraham is going to be explained subsequently. But Purti in this Narayana Mantram was initially highlighted clearly by Achan Pillai. Periya Achan Pillai has given a beautiful grantham named Parandarahasyam. In that Parandarahasyam, this exact section was explained by Periya Achan Pillai. Mamunigal just takes that section and he quotes it right directly here instead of writing in his own words. So this is the greatness of Mamunigal. Whenever there is an existing explanation, he would simply just take that and quote it and put things into perspective instead of trying to explain it himself. We can see it in many, many, many places. So that is 12th Sutram, where it is explained that for the other 2 mantras, we have these 2 defects, that is Ashishta Parigraham and Apurti. So, with this, we will stop today and we will see the next sutrams in the next session. Alvar Embermanar, G.R. Thiruvadigale Sharanam, G.R. Thiruvadigale Sharanam.
To learn such valuable information about our Sri Vaishnava Sampradaya, please download Koyil, K-O-Y-I-L app from Google Play Store or Apple App Store. Our website is koyil.org, K-O-Y-I-L.org.